So many of you have probably been working with the profiling. Some of you have probably been working with the profiling going all the way back to 6.1 and the online marketing suite. So essentially, over the many years, 9 years since we have profiling on the market, we basically have seen a couple of barriers to get started with profiling. The first barrier is typical, our naming convention. So once we try to explain profiling, then we have to explain a lot of different names and introduce how they are all related. The profile, profiling, profile cards, profile users, profile keys, and so forth. That definitely adds to the confusion of getting started with the profiling. Then it's also understanding what's the difference between profile cards and pattern cards. Why aren't they the same? And finally, it's what do you actually use? Do you use an average? Do you use a sum? Do you use a percentage? What are the different differences between those? So profiling is super powerful, but there's also a learning curve in order to understand how is this all connected and what's the good best practices use of profiling. So often when we talk about profiling and meet a lot of Sitecore customers, partners, etc., we end up doing a lot of explanation about how this is connected. And I can see the GIF I'm playing in the broadcast. And then the reaction we typically get is this, or even this with the crying eyes here. So that there is a lot of explanation, and that's also part of the reason we want to kick off the webinar series for strategists to really dive in to this. If we think about our platform and version 8, version 9, it's really been focusing on connecting data and using data in real time. So when I think about customer data and how we are able to collect and use customer data, many starts with the customer data, the one you have at the bottom. And then when I look at the Sitecore, essentially what we bring is additional layers of data that all contribute to understand the customer, their behavior, sentiment, the attitude, and so forth. So on the top, you have content data. So that is where profiling come in. So based on how you consume content, we're able to profile you, and we bring that in and can now look much more into the behavioral, attitude, sentiment side of this. And that's pretty unique. It's not just demographic or psychographic data, as you typically get with the customer data. It's bringing in all the behavior, the real-time intent, and then we can utilize that. Of course, if you use commerce or have a Commerce Connect, then you get another layer that can be what products have you looked at, what do you have in a basket, what have you bought, what's the amount you have bought for, what's the lifetime value, and so forth. If you also begin to use some of the taxonomies we have in Sitecore, you get marketing data, and marketing data can be related to, for instance, profiles. So marketing data can be, who are you targeting in the different campaigns? Who are the audience? What's the message? What are the products? So this is where you can use taxonomies and the campaign facets. And as soon as you trigger that and have someone coming in, we can act on that, or we can use that information to translate it into profiles. And now you can be much more operational efficient because you have fewer data points that you actually use as part of the personalization, instead of having very complex logic and rule sets where you listen to many different data points. So you can use profiles as the common data set that you use for personalization. And of course, into this mix, you can use XConnect to check the data that we have collected in Sitecore, share it, for instance, with a CRM system, where profile and the behavioral information is typical information that they don't have in a CRM system. So that will be very valuable to get that behavioral information into CRM, as well as taking any data you have from CRM or other system, bring it into a Sitecore, and now we get a more complete picture. and essentially would be able to deliver a better experience in context based on this data. But profile is a super, super important part of this equation, and often a brick that many of the other platforms are missing. When we look at profiling, as mentioned, it's an important brick, but also think about this brick as helping you go the last mile in terms of understanding what is the customer's intent and what are they really interested in. So, so of course, a profile can be helping you understand what persona type is this. And we have heard many customers, partners lead with personas as a profile. But often profile persona is the most complex profile to establish, because you need to have well-established personas. You need to have content that have been aligned to these different personas. And then you also need to have a proper set of content that is the right content to show in a personalization. So typical other profiles that is easier to start with is, for instance, the site interest. It's product categories. It could be a stage in a decision journey. It could be what area of the site are you looking at? Are you looking at job? Are you looking at products, services? Are you looking at thought leadership? And that can help determine your interest and help show much better content related to that. So so there's a lot of different options, and don't choose the hardest one. Choose what makes most sense in getting the information you need here. I will very quickly just go through the logic of setting up a profile. I won't dive in too deep, because many of you, this is probably a table stakes for. But if you look at a profile, then for instance, if we have a persona, which is, as mentioned, one of the hardest one, then I could have a situation where the company I work for had five different personas: Steve, Fiona, Mark, Richard, and Mary. So in order to set this up, the persona in this case, that's our profile. And then the different personas we have here, that will be our profile keys. Then when we create different presets, then we essentially have a radar diagram where we define the presets in. If we do absolutely nothing when we create the profile and the profile keys, then every time we profile content, we have to set the manual values. So for instance, this is a 5 in Steve, or this is a 3 in Fiona. The presets help us do that, so we can be much quicker in profiling content. So that's where profile cards come in. So a profile card is a preset where we can define that the Richard persona have a 5 in Richard. And now each time we apply this profile card, then the content that we apply this card to will get a 5 in value of Richard. So far, so good. So basically, we set this up. We set up the different profile cards, and we profile content. Then publish it. And now what happens is, when someone comes to the site, in this case, we have a visitor who is viewing 3 profile pages, and we use average, which I will explain just in a little while. Then the sum of this, the profile we put to the user, is basically start with best coverage, which have been profiled 5 in Richard, go to for the young family, which have been profiled with 5 in Mark, and go to compare coverage, which has been profiled with 5 in Richard. So now the sum of this using average is that the user profile will have 1.67 in Mark, 3.33 in Richard. So basically, average, you're adding these up. So it's 5 plus 0 plus 5 in Richard, 10, divided by the number of profile pages, 3. That's why you get 3.33. And in Mark, it's 5 divided by 3, and then you get 1.67. So now we have attached this to our visitor who's browsing the site. This is happening in real time. And in order to match them, we could use logic. For instance, if you have more than two in this profile and more than three in this profile, show this content. But that's a very manual process and will require a lot of work on your end. So to make that easy, that's why we use the pattern cards. So now, taking that example where we have the value of 1.67 in Mark and 3.33 in Richard, we can have different pattern cards that we essentially match to. So in this case, I have five pattern cards. Each one have high score in each of the five personas. So now Sitecore will use the Euclidean distance and basically match up which of these are closest. And then based on that will detect closest distance, will detect what is the right pattern card to match to this visitor. So in this case, this visitor profile will be matched to the Richard persona, which have high value on the Richard side here. So that's how it's working today. There's one element here, of course, and that is what is missing in these cards. Because if I just create these five pattern cards, then the visitors will always match one of those five cards. So what is typically missing here is you have a default card that can be a little bit in between for users that are browsing and will get profile values across the different keys. So typically you have a default card that have values in each of the keys for those cases that you are a little bit all over. So now we match them towards that. So we don't just begin to show them Richard messages if they are all over the place. So pattern card help you build up what to match, and it has a lot of flexibility because you can do a Richard with a Mark twist, a Richard with a Fiona twist, and so forth as you begin to understand the profiles of the different visitors. And you have full flexibility to create any spectrum of cards you would like. Could be you start more simple, you start with free cards where you have a catch-all for those people that are browsing all over. You have a card that is Mary Richard, a card that is more Richard Mark, and then based on this visitor profile, now the visitor will match this pattern card. So that's the flexibility, and that's why pattern cards and profile cards are not the same. In terms of where to apply profiles and where to personalize, then typical. We see that big impact pages, homepage, category pages, and so forth, that's typical where you apply the personalization. And then the very specific pages that is for certain interests, for certain groups, that's definitely where you profile the content. And then there's some in between that typical would also have some profiles attached to it. So if you have followed some of the documentation, the content we have, probably so far so good that you are all up to speed on what I have just explained so far. Let me take it up a little notch here, because a lot of the questions we seem to get is when do you use sum, when should you use average, percentage, and so forth. So let me just dive in and explain a little bit of the differences between sum and average. So basically what happens when a user is coming to your site, consuming content, is that we add in the profiles that was associated to the content, and we save that to the user. Then when we do the matching for the pattern cards, then we look at the score, and then if we use a sum, then we apply that for the matching. If you use average, we apply that for the matching. That also means you have some opportunity to change over time. So it's so that gives you some flexibility. If we look at an example of a visitor coming to a site, and we look at the difference between what will happen if we do the match based on sum versus average, then in this case where we have four keys, and the visitor goes to page A, where key one have been profiled with the five. Then if we have average, then you will now have five in key one, because you have visited one page and you have been profiled with five. If we use sum, then you will have the same. Then the visitor goes to another page, page B. So now you can see that now average begins to change, because we are basically dividing. You have five and five, and we're dividing that by two. So now the value we use for the match is 2.5 and 2.5. If we use sum, then we add on it. So now you will have five in key one and five in key two. Then you go to back to page A, you get five. So you can see average, you get a little bit higher, and three. And on sum, you get 10 and five. Then you continue to click on page A, page A. So now you can see average doesn't change that much, and sum, you can see you have the high score here. So the difference here is, if you use average, you don't have the intelligence here in terms of, is this a visitor who is very much engaged in this content we have based on the key one? We can tell that with the sum, because now we actually have a score that we can tell. If you are above 20, you are definitely very much interested in this type of content. And now we essentially add another dimension to the pattern cards creation that we can take into account. So a sum gives you much more insights in terms of how engaged the visitors are into your different topics, where average is easier to start with and basically will give you the direction, what is the interest of this visitor in real time. So if you look at sum versus average and when to use either of them, then average is really great, as mentioned, for pointers, where you just want to know, are they interested in this versus that. It's great for product services specific categories. It's definitely the most easy one to start with, as sum adds another dimension to it. Sum is awesome if you're using, for instance, lead score, churn score, because now sum will add to it as part of the matching. So you can basically score customers based on how engaged they are. Is it low engagement from 0 to 20? Is it medium engagement from 21 to 50? Is it high engagement for 51 and above? If you use sum, where you also have different keys, you you can really design your pattern cards with a lot of flexibility. So you can have pattern cards that are little interest in profile one, medium interest in profile one, high interest in profile one. And then if you have four and you do the same for the rest, then you will essentially end up with 16 different pattern cards plus the catch-all. So sum gives you a lot of flexibility, but it's also adding more complexity in terms of how you design the pattern cards and how you work with them. So that was very quick on sum versus average. If we go back to the persona and look into that, should you have a persona or shouldn't you have a persona, and what are some of the other options to also work with different profiles that could add up to a persona? What are your options there? So basically, and there's, again, you have a lot of flexibility, so there's different ways that you can construct your personas. One of the most simple examples is if you have five personas, Ehrlich, Peter, Richard, etc., then you can essentially create your personas like this, and pattern cards, where you have each of the personas, and now you can have profile cards that score high in each, and you can have pattern card that matches. So most Ehrlich, a little bit Peter, and a little bit Richard. I don't know if that's even possible in reality, but this would be a pattern card. You could also have a persona where the keys are different. So you could have one that would be a key that would be historical. You could have another one that would be other traits of a, of a human. And then basically you build up your personas, and Ehrlich persona card based on, is he methodical? He's probably not, he's more spontaneous, and so forth, based on the different traits you have. Both works. If you use it based on traits, it's a little bit more complicated, and you definitely need to have well-defined personas. Another way, and that is probably also one of the most common questions, can we have a persona that is on a higher level? So basically you have different profiles that add up to a higher level persona. It's not possible using the profiling, but it's possible if you, for instance, also use rules on top of this. So let me give you an example of that. You could have different profiles. In this case, you could have a product profile, you could have a stage in the life cycle profile, and you could have one that is more based on traits, competitive, methodological, spontaneous, humanistic. So we could have different profiles like this. So now we have three different profiles. Then we have different options. We could create a very detailed personas based on these. So now we have four keys here, five keys here, and four keys here. If we want to have one that is in research, interested in product B and highly competitive, one that is interested in product A in the attract phase, and they are humanistic, that would be different types of personas. If we did this based on these three cards with these keys, then we would basically add 80 new matches here, which probably is a little bit on the high end. We could also say we want to use the product interest, the traits of a person, and then we basically use two matches for the stage in life cycle. You are either in the early to mid stages, or you are ready to buy or a customer. And now we lower the amount of pattern cards that we, not pattern card, but the sum of personas that we match this against. So you have a lot of flexibility, and you might just look at two, or look at, you are either competitive, methodological, or spontaneous, humanistic, if you want to make any assumptions like that. But if you want to bring this up to a more high level persona, the way you do that is setting up a global rule. So for instance, in this case, I could create my methodological Ehrlich doing research and interest in product B. And the rule I will create is basically look into the existing rules I have for pattern match. And now I will select where visitor is methodological pattern card in the personality profile. That's the one at the bottom, where the current contact matches the research stage in the life side. That's the middle one, and where they're interested in profile B. That's the top one. So now this rule is essentially looking at three different profiles, and if they match these different patterns, then it's true. And now I can use this rule for personalization. So since it's a global rule, I just call where this is true, then show this content for the visitors. And of course, you can have a lot of different matches here if you really want to go into the details, or you start with a fewer. But there's definitely some hacks you can do to work with a more high level persona, and then use profiles to basically define interest and different traits of a person. Okay, on to some of the next, and that's that can also be a little bit complicated because what are the different values you actually use when you define a profile, and based on that, how do you create your different pattern matches? So here you really have to work with being very methodological in how you set up the patterns and basically run through different scenarios. Let me give you an example. So I typically use this Excel. And in this Excel, I just highlighted average and the sum. So here I have a couple of patterns, and this is I would have loved to show you this slide, but here I have three patterns. First one is you're interested most in key one. Second pattern is you don't have a specific interest, so that's more like a catch all. And then pattern three is you're mostly interested in key two here. So now what I do in this Excel is you have the number of page views. So you go to page one, you get a score of 5 in key one and 0 in key two. You go to page two, you get a score of 0 in key one, 5 in key two. You go to page three, you get a score of 5 in key one and 0 in key two. And you go to page four, you get a score of 5 in key one and 0 in key zero. So on the total, you can see how much do we actually have on the visitor. So we add that up over time when I hit the different pages. What you can see here is what will I actually match? If I have my match based on average, what is the distance if my cards here are set to 1 in a pattern 1 with key 1 and 0 in key 2, 1, 1 in a pattern card 2, and 0, 1 in a pattern card 3. So now you will see that based on this, I will first match pattern card 1. The distance is 16. And then I will match pattern card 2. So basically no specific side interest. If I look at the sum, it's the same results, but the distance is, you can see the distance gets bigger and bigger. So it's further along. If I change my pattern card keys here, watch what happens. So if I say it's a 5 and a 2-2 in the catch all and a 5, then you can see the distance change, and also it changed which match I am getting. If I change it, for instance, so it's a 10, 2, 2, and 10, then it's very different. And if I have a maximum value on my profiles for 5, then I might go with something like this, a 3, 4, 4, and a 3. And then you can see again, it's different, but on average, this is more realistic in terms of what I'm trying to accomplish, because 5, then I want them to match pattern card 1. If it's 5-5, I want them to match pattern card 2, as that no specific sub interest. And as I get more value in key 1, I want them to match the pattern card 1. So average work for me here, if I have a sum, again, you can see then the last two is not what I expected here. So, but of course it makes sense. That's the way sum works. And in that, if that is the case, then I need to re-evaluate my pattern cards and probably add more because I'm working with the sum. So, so this is a super important step to really analyze the potential outcomes of how your visitors will match and how you're using patterns to match them against. So I highly recommend doing some of this, like using Excel to walk through a couple of scenarios with different calculations. Very quickly, some of the other stuff on profiling. Again, there's different values. You set the boundaries for what is the max value for the profiles and the profile cards. We typically see having lower values, so like starting with 0 to 5 makes a lot of sense. If you have more profiles and more profile keys in place, you might go a little bit higher, 0 to 10 or 0 to 12. If it's more lead score, then it's higher numbers. You can be very engaged if you do a certain action, and typically you have a max value of a higher there, typical 100. But if it's profiles with different keys, we typically see the lower value as the maximum. Also keep in mind from 8.1, you have decay rate on profiles. And essentially what that means is once you have a visitor coming into your site that have already been on your site and have been profiled, then you can decay that profile value that they had before, which is stored in the XDB. So for instance, if you have 10 in a profile key 1000, and then you have a decay rate at 50, then once they hit the site, that 10 will be decayed by 50%. And now the starting profile will be a 5 for that visitor. So that gives you a lot of flexibility to basically continue the conversation based on past interest. And then whatever you lay on top of that will have a higher influence in terms of what is your current interest in this visit. So DK rate is very cool. Some things you want to put a higher DK rate on, some you want to put a lower DK rate on. Because if you have someone that have a high lead score from the past, you don't want to DK that. You want to have that logic and understand this one was highly engaged. And then you can be much more direct in terms of some of the call to actions that you present for that user. So that was a lot of stuff in terms of a lot of the mechanics on the profiling and some of the more capabilities that the typical courses questions that we have seen over the past couple of years. Let me shift gears here and talk a little bit about connecting the dots and how a profile helps you be much more operational efficient. Essentially, if we look at a scenario where you create different campaigns or your customers create different campaigns, marketing campaigns could be PPC, could be display advertising, could be an email sent out. So now using Sitecore, you can attach a campaign to that. You have the visitor coming in on your site, leaving, coming back, signing up for an email. So now we go from unknown to known. You send out an email, the visitor clicks on that email and come back in. So very typical scenario. So if we look at the connecting the dots here, and essentially you have different audiences that you are targeting. Let's say a potential customer, a partner, an existing customer, or a job candidate. Then using campaign creator, you're able to use the campaign facets. So now you could have one facet that is essentially audience, and you could have selected that this campaign bringing this visitor in was targeting a potential customer. So now you know every one of those clicking on this campaign is a potential customer, and you can start treating them like that. And this is where you would use the campaign facet and basically boost a profile key for potential customer. And now personalization happens on the profile and not the facets, because that's easier to maintain. Then, of course, as soon as you come in, we start building the experience profile and build up more of your profile in terms of interest, etc. You have, of course, our different capabilities. You can do tests, more personalization, page tests, etc. And you can also use marketing automation to orchestrate the journey from unknown to known, and what the experiences to share. All of this and all of the data based on the behavior of the visitor is stored. And now you can go into experience analytics, which is much more marketing business oriented, not really a tool you will use for a digital analyst. But if you're a digital analyst, then you will go into Path Analyzer or extract the data into Power BI and do much more deep dive in terms of behavior and understanding what can actually be done to boost getting the right audience in and to boost the experience to get the conversions that you are striving for. So this is what you can do today. And this is where you can map the campaign facets to a profile. What we are focusing on, and as you will be hearing much more coming later this year, then it's really applying the Cortex engine here. So every data that you collect is of course very important to feed Cortex and to use machine learning on top of that. Remember, quality data in, quality experiences out. So investing in proper profiling and using it will be a great advantage, because you will be able to feed machine learning using that profile. And essentially where you will be able to go over the next couple of releases is you can use that to have Cortex focusing on what is the right campaigns and optimize those campaigns to get the right audience in, as well as optimize the experience. So it's much more automated in terms of showing the right content with the highest propensity to get the action that you are striving for. So profiling is definitely the glue to work with different data sets and give you that data you need. I have a couple of examples, and since I can't demo it, it's just a couple of screenshots. So, for instance, if you wanna boost profiles, then you can, for instance, use marketing automation to do that. So here's a very simple flow where we have someone coming in from a campaign. It's not just a campaign, but it can actually be any campaign in a certain group. So we also set it up so it can scale, and we don't have to change the logic every time we create a new campaign. Then we can have a listener that basically listen into a facet. We ship with a couple of conditions here, but you can extend it. We don't ship with a campaign facet condition out of the box, but that's pretty easy to add in. Then basically we listen to what are the audience on a campaign facet, and based on if you have a prospect customer or existing customer or potential partner, then you can boost certain profile values based on that. And that's real time. So that's how you, for instance, can make the match between one data set and then boost profile value based on that. So very simple. You have a lot of flexibility, and there's also different ways to do it. You don't have to use marketing automation. You can set up custom logic, custom rules, etc. You can also use it, for instance, as a listener, if you use lead scoring. That's a little bit hard to see here, but basically my condition in this case is I'm listening to a threshold of lead scoring. So as soon as you hit above 50 in lead scoring, I want to add you to a list, and that list can be used for retargeting. It can be used if it's known emails and I have permission to also begin to nurture you based on that. But basically, I listen in real time to a change in profile value, and then I orchestrate you should be on this list. And from that list, I have different conditions and different actions I can take from that. So that's an example of how you can use it as well. And of course, it's in the analytics. So out of the box, you have a couple of reports. So for instance, you can look for pattern matches by value, by visits. But what really is important is to look at the efficiency, which is the value per visit. So in this case, which is something Dollywood presented and allowed us to share, which is a great example, you can see that if you look at value and visits, they have a lot of interest in their theme park. That's most of the value, that's most of the visits. But if you look at the value per visit in this case, then it's the efficiency. And of course, the purchase funnel is high efficient because people are checking out and many of them end up buying tickets for the park. But what you can use this for is, for instance, theme park is actually not that high efficient. And then water park, which is the third most visited segment, is a much higher efficiency. So now, just based on identifying that, you could have two tactics. Need to run more test personalization for those visitors interested in the theme park, because there's a good opportunity to get them to convert more. And looking back to the visitors that are interested in the water park, and look at the inbound campaigns and boost them more, invest more in them, because they have a higher propensity to convert and essentially buying tickets. So there's a lot of opportunity to really dive into that. And then of course, you can use profiles and matches for to set up your own custom path analyzer maps. So in this case, on a car dealer website, I have a luxury car buyer, which is based on a profile. And now using a path analyzer, I'm able to see what is the behavior for all those visitors matching that card. Or if you take the data and put it into, for instance, Power BI, in this case, I have a very simple dashboard where I look at my profiles as converters, heroes, inerts, and attractors. So basically, you can see I have different dots here, which is based on the profile match, how many visits, what is the value, and then I'm able to see if they are high converters, but not that high traffic, if they are high traffic but not that high value, and then use it to make the right decision in terms of optimization. The good thing about getting data out and do much more drill down is if I, for instance, in this case, have it in Power BI, I can select a certain pattern match here. And now I get insights into what are the right campaigns, what are the right content, etc. So now I have drilling in a whole new way that really gives me a lot of detailed insights about these visitors matching these specific cards I have set up. And then you can also use profiles together with a module that is available on GitHub, which we call Relevant Content Detect. This works on 8, but you have access to the source if you want to create a 9.0 branch for it. We call it Relevant Content Detect. And how it works is we basically you can profile any content. So now you can profile, for instance, different call to actions. And now based on those call to actions, you can automate what is the right call to action to show based on the visitor's profile. So essentially what we are trying to do is do a little bit of semi-automated personalization and get away from situations where the customer want to have the highest content with the highest propensity shown to the customer, but they want to avoid setting up a lot of rules here. So based on profiling the different call to actions, for instance here, where we apply a profile to it, then we the module basically allows you to select a component. And on that component, I don't know if it's that clear to see here, but on that component, you point to the folder. So in this case, my folder is the RCD site interest content, which have different content below it. Then I set up the logic. What is the profile I will match on? What is my algorithm I will match on? In this case, I use closest, but there's also some based on Euclidean on a fuzzy logic. So we both have Euclidean distance and fuzzy logic. What is my default content to show if you're not profiled? So this is the logic. And then we point to a folder. So basically now all you have to do is just add content into this folder, profile it, and then it goes into the equation and help automate what the visitor will see. So I definitely, if you use profile a lot, I definitely recommend that you take a look at that module, as it really helps semi-automate the personalization side of this.